Colin Cowherd has determined once again it's a good idea to piss off the Browns, the city of Cleveland, and seemingly the state of Ohio to drive clicks and views. This is Mike's Takes. Welcome to the Brownie Postgame YouTube channel. Stay tuned as we break it all down.
Here we go, Brownies! Here we go!
So I figured out what Colin's doing. He's latching on to the most interesting story, the most interesting thing that's out there, and he wants to talk about it, because that's how you drive ears and eyes and views and clicks and all that good stuff that really helps them drive then advertisers to say, hey, more people are listening or viewing or doing whatever for this, so give us more money to advertise, right? So he has to latch on to the most interesting thing. And right now, football in America is still the most interesting sport, and the Cleveland Browns right now are the most interesting team in said sport. So he's latching on to us, and due to our offseason, all the energized Browns fans all around the world, and really everybody in the NFL, due to our offseason moves, are really excited and interested in what's going on with the Browns. So he's latching on. You also notice that he's got this little feud that goes back and forth with Baker Mayfield. So, I mean, Baker Mayfield right now is the most popular player, arguably, on the Browns. I mean, yes, we got Odell and we got some other really nice pieces, but honestly, right now, Baker Mayfield's the most exciting thing that we got. So he's got this back and forth that started before the draft when he called him undraftable, when he had him on his show. It was a legendary interview that Baker really stood toe-to-toe, and by all everyone's accounts out there, is like, hey, he really owned him, you know? So Colin's figured that out, and so he keeps going back and forth and giving us some takes and what his opinions are and everything, and using his sources and giving us, you know, the real facts about what's going on, and so he says. So we're going to break that all down today, and I'm going to tell you where he's right and where he's wrong. All right, so let's start off with a quote here from Fox Sports before we get into the video. Fox Sports, the sister profile of Fox NFL, that wonderful Twitter handle that's doing the bracket for the best fans in the NFL with the controversy there with the Bills and the Titans. Real good job, Fox. You're doing great. All right, so nobody will be honest about this Cleveland thing. And it's a thing. That's what we are, a thing. It has a chance to be a complete and utter dumpster fire. Everything has a chance to be a complete and utter dumpster fire. I mean, that's a pretty soft take. He's not saying it is. He's not saying it will be. There's nothing definitive about this. Well, there's just a chance. Okay. There's a chance anything could be a dumpster fire. Odell didn't want to go here. I mean, that's debatable as well. The owner's a control freak. John Dorsey's a control freak. So those are two definitive statements that he's saying. He backs it up a little bit later here in the video. Freddie Kitchens could be over his head, dot, dot, dot. Again, that could. So again, he's not saying like, hey, he's not actually coming out and giving an opinion that says, hey, hold me to this. Hold me accountable to this, you know, 6 months into the season. You know, when it's all said and done, when we go back and look at it. Because he's saying it could. Because you can go, hey, I just said it could. I'm not saying it is or it will. It just could, right? As anybody's watched Colin in the past and knows, not every one of his takes are dead on. He's very often wrong when it comes to his opinion stuff. So, all right. So let's go ahead and break down into the video.
The Cleveland Browns now are that story. So the Cleveland Browns finished in third place last year, had a losing record, are historically a joke. The owner, Tennessee.
So let's just start there. A lot of people have said that they don't believe in Cleveland, that it's because of historical trends that we should be dismissed moving forward into the future. And yeah, it's easy to say that having looked at what we've been in the past. But this team, this roster that we have, this coaching staff, the front office, is wildly different than anything we've had in the past, at least since we've been back in 99, arguably going back to this is the best that we've had, the most stability that we've had since, you know, maybe ever, maybe since Paul Brown, okay? So to say that it's just like, hey, you know what? The first statement he makes is very dismissive, saying don't take them seriously because they've been historically bad. You know what, Colin, you can live in the past all you want, but we're moving forward. We're looking into the future. Let's continue on.
Football's a mess, and the Browns are a mess. They both have the same guy running them.
It's hard to say that. Why would you say that the Browns are a mess right now? You've got free agents that are determined. They're deciding to go to the Browns, and we're not. I mean, the trades are one thing, but we have free agents that are coming to the Browns because they want to be a part of this. You've got other people that when they're leaving, they don't look all that excited to be leaving because they know that what's going on right now with the Browns is really exciting. This is a good times ahead. To call the Cleveland Browns a mess, I think, is a bit of an overstatement. I mean, during the Hugh Jackson years, the 1-15, the 0-16, absolutely, I would agree. But the 7-8-1 Browns, I would argue, are completely on the upswing and ready to take the giant step forward in the next season. So let's continue on.
Freddie Kitchens has never coached, would never even.
Freddie Kitchens has been an NFL coach for a very, very long time. And if you look back and you watch his interviews and they ask him about, well, why haven't you been considered for a head coach in the past? I mean, he's got a pretty decent answer for that. He's just always been himself. He's not been a big guy on self-promotion. He's a very humble person, and there's nothing wrong with that. So the fact that he hasn't been a head coach before, I'm not really all that concerned.
Interviewed for a coordinator job. He's had it for 8 years. And now he gets Odell Beckham. He's got stars. You've got an ego at general manager. And nobody will just say the truth.
Okay. So if you look at Freddie Kitchens, he's had egos. He's had stars in the past. And everywhere he's gone, he's made them better. And the people that they talk about Freddie Kitchens, they talk about him with reverence. This isn't somebody that it's his first coaching job ever, and they're just getting some fresh guy out of nowhere and just throwing him in there. I mean, this is a guy who's earned it. It's unfortunate that Colin hasn't done his homework and doesn't know that, but everybody who's been around Cleveland, or at least for the last season, and seen what Freddie does, the relationship he's built with Baker Mayfield, with John Dorsey. I mean, think about this too. The guy went from a running back coach to being elevated to offensive coordinator. As soon as he was elevated to offensive coordinator, everything started clicking and doing really well. And then not having been interviewed for a head coach before, not being offered the job in the past, he is given the job. And you think John Dorsey is just going to hand that over? This chessboard that he's been creating over the last couple seasons now, you think the Browns are just going to hand that over to anybody who they don't think deserves it and they don't think can handle it? It's a really rough take there, Colin.
Odell Beckham's not happy here. He's not happy.
Okay. So let's talk about the Odell Beckham, because he does get into body language. He starts talking about some stuff there too, and I noticed that. I mean, if you look at it, and he's going to get into some of the other points that he's going to make here about why he feels that Odell's not happy to be in Cleveland. So number one, think about it from Odell's perspective. Odell has been playing out of the city of New York with very passionate fans of every sport, one of the biggest cities in the United States. And he's got a lot of fans, a lot of people who bought Odell Beckham jerseys. Now, I think what Odell's doing is very smart. You know, he's not leaving like Antonio Brown did in Pittsburgh. He's not doing it like LeBron did when he did the decision and came to Miami and everybody burned his jersey. He was traded. He didn't do it on his own. He was traded by his organization. And instead of pissing off all the Giants fans that love him, who looked at him as a hero, who supported him and bought his jersey and did all that stuff, he's looking at it like, guys, I didn't want to leave. I was really happy here. It took me a while to really internalize all of it. Still kind of like in shock because of all of it. I think a lot of that is true as well. But I think it's smart what Odell is doing. He's looking at it playing almost like playing the victim, saying, well, this was done to me. I didn't get to do this. And I think the result of that, the fans in New York are more, disappointed and heartbroken, and they're now directing their anger at the organization and their general manager versus the player himself. If he comes out and says, I couldn't wait to get out of New York. New York was the dumpster fire. I hated the GM. I hated the owner. I hated the quarterback. I didn't think I had a future there. There's a lot of bad things that are going to come out of that. His whole brand would be severely bruised, and I think it would hurt him moving forward going into Cleveland. Now, if he goes back and plays in New York, they're going to give him a standing ovation. So, yeah, I mean, I think his body language, a little bit is honest. I think he was shocked. I think he was like, he is still in shock about what's going on with it. But to say that he didn't want to go there, that he absolutely didn't, he only wanted to go to L.A., it's a little nuts. Let's continue on.
Look at him. Does he look happy? Saquon Barkley came out. This got buried in the story. Oh. Saquon Barkley came out and said he didn't react for a couple of days when Odell, his teammate, went to Cleveland. And he said, we talked over FaceTime. He just gotten traded. He was not happy about it. By the way.
Okay. So again, you're going to look at a guy that you've been friends with, that you were teammates with last year, a guy who's a star in the NFL, somebody that you're going to want to align. This is smart. He wants to align himself with Saquon. Oh, by the way, Saquon and Baker are really good friends as well. You're going to sit there and spit in his face and be like, ha, I'm out of there. F you. Good luck. I mean, no, he's going to be like, you know what? I'm really disappointed. You know, I wanted to. And I think deep down, Odell would have loved to stay in New York. And if he could have got Jarvis and Baker and all the stuff, if he could transplant the Browns to New York, I think he'd be very happy doing that as well. But it doesn't mean that he's not happy being in Cleveland. It doesn't mean that he's not super excited to be on one of the highest potential quarterbacks in the league, if not the highest potential quarterback in the league, with Baker Mayfield after just setting the rookie touchdown passing record. Odell wants to do great things with his career. He wants to be remembered, not just for like one catch. He wants to be remembered with a Hall of Fame career. He wants to have postseason stuff going on. He knows he had no chance of that in New York. And he's got a big chance now in Cleveland. So whatever his body language is in press conferences or whatever thing like that, I take that with a grain of salt and look at it. That could be more strategy than actual, you know, on the surface honesty. Let's continue on.
I talked to Odell Beckham. I talked about this about 2 months ago. He never...
2 months ago. That is a... You look at 2 months ago versus 2 weeks, in the last 2 weeks, that is a world. The entire world started spinning the opposite direction in the last 2 weeks. You're talking, that's an old take. He had no idea that there was even a possibility of him ending up being A, traded, or B, being traded to Cleveland or anywhere, right? 2 months ago. So of course he's going to say all like, you know, I'm really happy. This is where I want to be. I signed the big contract, all that kind of, come on, Colin.
Never mentioned Cleveland. Don't buy into this Jarvis Landry thing. There is no NFL player that is more LA and New York.
Don't buy into this Jarvis Landry thing. He's taking his best friend, somebody he's known, who's probably has the most honest relationship with out of anybody outside of his family. Somebody he calls his brother, he's known since high school. Somebody he's played with, he's respected. They've come up together, and he's just dismissing it as this Jarvis Landry thing. Everybody, I think this is one of the most egregious statements that he makes in the entire video. I think this is absolutely ridiculous, and I don't think he just brushes it all. Again, he's dismissing these things, that there's a lot of weight there. You don't think Odell wants to play with Jarvis? Jarvis said he started crying. A grown man started crying when he found out that his best friend and one of the most talented receivers in the NFL is going to come to your team, make your team better, give you more opportunities, take some of the weight off of the defense who's double-teaming you. They can't do that anymore. You don't think that's an important thing to both Jarvis and Odell? Coming from LSU, everybody at LSU, anybody who's from LSU is watching this video. Was it a Jarvis Landry thing when they were both playing on the same team, setting records in the purple and yellow? I don't think so. Let's continue.
In Paris, than Odell Beckham. He is an icon. He's a star. He's probably the most talented guy. I think he's the most talented wide receiver in the NFL.
Okay, well, I mean, that's also very debatable. I mean, it's also kind of like a slight to guys like Julio Jones. But anyway, let's go.
Injury problems worry me. But nobody...
Injury problems worry me. So he's saying like, okay, yeah, there's. I am putting a little doubt out there because I'm a little bit worried about the injuries. Well, yeah, I mean, nobody's more worried about injuries than the Browns are. I think that is the whole thing relies on being healthy, right? Everything falls down to that. It's going to be tragic. We lose one of the players, Baker or Odell or Nick or Miles or any of the big stars on the team. It's going to be really tough. So we got to stay healthy. So we're worried about that too, Colin. We are.
We'll just be honest about this Cleveland thing. It has a chance to be a complete and utter dumpster fire.
Everything has a chance to be a complete and utter dumpster fire, including your show.
But if you say that, you're going to get major pushback from Cleveland and their fans because, I don't know, maybe because, I don't know, Ohio's very active on Twitter.
Okay, so this is kind of like one of the first things that is really kind of hinted me off to the fact that he's doing this intentionally. He knows that the Browns fans and the state of Ohio are really, really passionate and active on Twitter, as you can tell by the Fox NFL or NFL on Fox, whatever that is, whatever the handle is that's doing the bracketed fan base thing. So he knows that we're going to react. He knows that he's going to get the reaction from guys like Baker, who's also incredibly popular on Twitter, and get us and kick the hornet's nets and get us all riled up. So he's doing this intentionally because he absolutely knows that was a Freudian slip. He's giving us his strategy right now.
Nobody will say, be honest about this. This thing has a chance to be an absolute mess. Freddie Kitchens?
So what? Yeah, of course it does. Every team in the league does, Colin. Just because we now are excited, we're not allowed. If you're a Cleveland Brown fan, you're not allowed to be excited about anything. You don't get to be excited if you're a Browns fan. Because Colin Cowherd has determined that it could be a dumpster fire. Right? So you're not allowed to be excited. Everybody else can, but not you.
With these egos and these stars and these, I can tell you I have this as well-sourced as I can have it.
Well, and this is also really debatable. So this is funny how he does this.
And Odell Beckham. He didn't want to go to Cleveland. He wanted to go to L.A. And I got this source. He's not happy. And I keep watching him. I'm like, the guy didn't look that happy.
Yeah, again, we kind of tackled this a little bit. I think there's some strategy involved with the body language and everything going into it. But to say that he has some he's as well-sourced as he can, right? What sources are we going off of? And he's going to go into this in the next kind of part of his
Now,
of his
he'll
video.
Make it work, but this was not his choice. And this is a bad organization that can't win and haven't been hired.
To say this is a bad organization that can't win, again, if you're talking about historical, if you don't buy stock, right, based on the historical trends, you buy stock on what's going to happen in the future. That's how it's done. Everybody is buying stock in the Cleveland Browns right now. Everybody is. Because they know. They look at the roster. They look on paper. You got Baker Mayfield, the quarterback, coming off a historical year. You got a tight end, David Njoku, who's very exciting and very capable. You've got Nick Chubb, Kareem Hunt, going to be there in the middle of the season. Jarvis, Odell, Higgins, Callaway. You've got energy. You've got players on the team. Everybody's buying it, okay? So if you want to consider us the 0-16, the 1-15, the 3-13, you can do that all you want, Colin, but I'm not buying that.
I think the last time they beat the Steelers in the division was like the 80s. It was like 1989.
I'm not going to even go back and do the math because I don't even know what he's saying there. The last time they beat them in the division, who are above the Steelers? Again, 1989, the last 30 years, doesn't matter. Just matters what's happening moving forward.
So everybody, if you say this, people are going to freak out. Just like 8 years ago, I said in Aaron Rodgers, read his body language. Read his body language. Watch him. Watch Jay Cutler's body language. He's hard to get along with. Then it came out, Jay Cutler's hard to get along with. Now the stuff's coming out in Aaron Rodgers. If you watch this Odell Beckham stuff.
This is the other thing. So you notice if you watch Colin's clips, he's really, he's latching on to the Browns. He's latching on to LeBron in the Laker organization and the Green Bay Packers. So these are the three things that he's determined are the most controversial and where the drama exists in the sports world right now. So he's really, really not high on Aaron Rodgers. I don't really know a whole lot about Aaron Rodgers. I don't follow the Packers. I don't really care what's going on. I don't follow really NFC that closely until it gets to playoff time or if I'm looking at fantasy stuff. But to say that he's like, I've been right about Aaron Rodgers all along. I've been right about this and that. It's like, all right, man. I mean, like, you're not this isn't some amazing take that only Colin has figured out. Like he said, other people have said it as well.
Just do a little sourcing on this. This thing has a chance to be an absolute mess.
I know. You said it. You said that several times.
By the way, NFL executives were quoted in a story. Who did this story?
He doesn't even know who did this story. He's just saying that NFL executives could be literally anything. It could be anybody who is in the owner's meetings or at the combine or at pro day. It could be literally anybody. So, and he doesn't even know who it is who's putting it out there.
ESPN did a story. NFL execs were quoted on the Browns.
Just ESPN did.
Here are the quotes. I know we're in the era of fake news, but these are people that would lose their jobs if there were fake quotes.
Yeah, nobody ever, either way, who gives a crap what the if they're fake or not? You're not actually saying who said them. You're just executive one on Brown's free agency move. Executive one, then he goes executive two. What is that? You know, and who, and honestly, if you listen to what these guys are saying, I think there's a bit of jealousy that's in this, a little bit of resentment. I think the league is really scared. This could be the Giants. All guys from the Giants are really pissed off that they lost Odell and the way that they lost him. Let's continue on.
Said an NFL executive. These are executives in the league. The Browns are like the guy you knew in college. He was super fun to watch on Friday and Saturday night, but you didn't want to get too close.
Okay. The Browns are going to be on TV a lot next year. A lot. And again, that's going to really bother the teams that are used to having the Thursday night, the Sunday night, the Monday night games, right? So they're not happy that the team that has been really kicked around for the last 20 years is now kind of the darling of the NFL, is going to take a lot of the spotlight. So what? You know, if they're saying that, you know, Friday, and they're even saying Friday and Saturday night. So like they're specifically calling out the fact that they're jealous of the Browns. And the excitement that surrounds the team.
I don't see a long-term plan to retain players. I don't see a strategy. It's just, let's just grab some players and win.
No, that's insane. You look at what the Browns are doing, what Sashi put in place. You look at the Browns, anybody who's actually in the know with the Browns or who's been following them for the last couple of years can tell exactly, this all has been planned. They're not winging any of this. You look at the guys that they're bringing in, they're 25, 26-year-olds. We were the youngest team in the NFL last year by far. Once you took Tyrod out, I mean, I don't know if there was a single player over 30 years old. Every player was under 26, right? And the vast majority of them were under 25. And that's the heart. And not to mention the fact that the stars of the team were all under 25. Baker, Miles, Njoku, Nick. They were all there. So if you don't think that this was by design, that's an absolute ridiculous, asinine statement.
Another executive said, I respect adding talent. I'm just leery of a lot of this talent.
I respect adding talent. I'm leery about some of the talent. Okay, so again, we're not allowed, if you're Cleveland Brown, if you're in the Browns organization, you're not allowed to bring in talent. You're not. Everybody else can. The Raiders can do it. The Patriots can do it. Everybody else who's been real active in the offseason, you're allowed to do it. But not the Browns, who are bringing in guys that all fit the same profile, all gel well together, both having played in the past together or are lifelong best friends. But yeah, they're this executive too is leery of some of the talent.
Another one said, "Can a first-time head coach like Freddie Kitchens manage all these personalities?" By the way, another one.
Yeah, he absolutely can. Listen to Freddie Kitchens. Everybody loves the guy. He's the most homey, down-to-earth, salt-of-the-earth human. I'd go to Freddie Kitchens' church if I lived around the guy. I mean, that I liked the guy, right? I mean, think about this, okay? And not to mention the fact that he's managed personalities in the past, and obviously he's gained the respect of guys like Baker, the real big personalities. I mean, that is 100% documented, okay? How many NFL coaches out there are really worth a damn anyway? Okay, look at this offseason. Look at the guys who got hired. Right, and then look at all the other NFL coaches that are out there outside of like Belichick, you know, and Andy Reid. I mean, how many coaches out there are like the legendary guys? And oh, by the way, they weren't even available. So we went out and got a guy that proved that he was ready. He proved he had the respect of the locker room, the respect of the most important person in the locker room. He had a very exciting and risk-taking offense that was new and refreshing. And the Browns knew that if they didn't retain him, they didn't keep him on the staff, he was going to be gone next year anyway. So why not build around the young guy, the young organization, the core of your team, which is young, and bring in the coach who's also got some years. He's not a retread. This is a guy you can grow with. You know, like Schottenheimer in the 80s. Become great with him, right? Let's continue on.
said on Kareem Hunt, I think he was worth the risk to at least bring him in the building, but he did grow up 40 minutes away from Cleveland where he got into trouble, could get into trouble again. Good. By the way, Kareem Hunt, by the way, got suspended in college, and he's been suspended in the NFL, so he's got a little bit of stuff with him. Again,
He's sitting out for 8 games, and the Browns have said, we want to bring this guy in and have him be a part of the team. We don't want to let him out there for 8 weeks of the season and have him potentially make mistakes. We want to have him be a part of this team, so when he suits up, everybody's going to be going nuts when Kareem Hunt, arguably the best running back in the NFL, everybody's sitting there like, you know, he got in trouble and he got suspended from the league and all this different stuff and he got released by the Chiefs. It's like he can't run the football anymore. Kareem Hunt, ask anybody who played fantasy football ever, really, if Kareem Hunt was a guy that you want. He was a top five pick in just about every league last year. He's one of the best running backs in the NFL, and he's going to be our backup. Yeah, can he get in trouble? Sure. Has he gotten in trouble in the past? Sure, but he's with a guy, John Dorsey, that that he wasn't getting in trouble with when he was on the Chiefs. Guy who brought him in.
Take general sourcing, you can figure that out. But this is the story about the Browns that everybody's afraid to just talk about. Odell didn't want to go here. Odell's not happy. The owner's a control freak. John Dorsey's a control freak. Freddie Kitchens could be over.
That's a strong word saying control freak. I would go and say the owner, I would say the Haslams definitely struggled. I mean, there's no arguing that the Haslams have struggled. But I think they've also finally realized that they have to give up that control. They got to give up to a guy who knows exactly what he's doing, who has a plan and is executing upon that plan, who's had success in the past. If you look at the guys that John Dorsey has drafted, I mean, this guy doesn't miss. And if you're going to hand your franchise over to somebody and entrust him with making the moves to bring you to get you out of that hole, John Dorsey has proven that he is the absolute perfect human being on the planet to do that. Not only the respect of the other people within the front office, getting rid of all the leakers and all the people like that, but then also the players themselves and the locker. I mean, he's an ex-player. He's a locker room guy. He's been around football his entire life. He's earned the respect. And I'm sorry that it bothers Colin and maybe some other people around the league, but he's one heck of a good GM. And I think it's tough to say. I don't necessarily agree that the Haslams are control freaks anymore. And I'm completely happy that John Dorsey is control of the organization. Let's continue.
His head. I'm not even mentioning Baker, who's a kid. He's just a baby.
That was designed to get Baker's attention. And obviously, if you see the tweet that Baker responds with, he was a little bit upset with that. Baker has owned Colin every chance he's had. And to say that he's a baby and he's a kid is really, really difficult. Did he say that about Russell Wilson? Did he say that about, you know, Dak Prescott? Did he say that about other young quarterbacks who have had success right out of the gate? Did he say that about Pat Mahomes? Is Pat Mahomes a kid? Is he a baby? NFL MVP, 50 touchdowns? Is he saying that about Pat?
You're going to get blowback if you say this stuff because everybody wants to celebrate Odell.
Because you're wrong. You're saying it and you're wrong. That's why you're getting blowback. Not because it's like some wild take out there. You're dead wrong, Colin. I'm looking right at you. You're dead wrong. That's why you're getting blowback.
Odell Beckham didn't want to go to Cleveland.
Yeah, he did. Yeah, I think Odell absolutely wanted to go to Cleveland. He wanted to play with Jarvis. He wanted to play with Baker. You look at the pictures that these guys are friends. We think back to Hard Knocks last year when the Giants were playing the Browns. I use this in my Stranger Browns video, plugging that. You wait to the end, you see them hugging and embracing. These aren't guys that don't know each other. These are guys that get along. This is game, acknowledging and respecting game. Okay, so this is Odell is a lot happier than maybe he's leading on with his body language.
Browns now are that story. So the Cleveland Browns
That's why
finished in third place last year, had a losing record, are historically a joke.
You still look at it. You go from 1-15, 0-16 to 7-8-1. I would say that's a massive step forward. That there was excitement. We were in the playoff talk all last year up to the very end. And even after we were mathematically eliminated from it, we were still selling out and still watching the games, and everybody was excited. We wanted those wins at the end. We wanted the wins. To say that we've been historically bad to dismiss us again is really it's a flawed take there too.
The owner, Tennessee football's a mess, and the Browns are a mess.
I don't know anything about
they both
Tennessee
have the same guy running them.
Tennessee football, I think, has been a mess for a while because I don't think they've been really relevant since Peyton Manning was on the team. So I can't really argue there. And I don't know really what Jimmy's involvement is on with Tennessee. But, I mean, it's not like you can own a college team. I mean, he may be, like, one of the strongest backers of Tennessee football, but it doesn't mean he's, like, in control of the University of Tennessee.
Freddie Kitchens has never coached, was never even interviewed for a coordinator job. He's had it for eight. And now he gets Odell Beckham.
Yeah.
He's got stars.
That's good.
You've got an ego at general manager. And nobody will just say the truth. Odell Beckham's not happy here.
Okay. So he says that Freddie doesn't deserve it. He shouldn't have gotten it. You got a bunch of egos. You got a bunch of stars out there that he's going to have to manage. Again, I look at a guy like Freddie Kitchens. And I say, I want him managing the team. I want this guy involved. I want this guy. I think Freddie is going to be the glue that keeps it all together. I think he's going to do great. I think we've surrounded Freddie with other great coaches as well. I think everybody's going to buy into the philosophy, and people are really excited. They're excited about Dorsey. They're excited about Freddie. They're excited about the core players that we have in the team. So to just outright dismiss the guy because he hasn't met your qualification for deserving the head coach. He doesn't say like, hey, you know what? They gave it to Freddie. They should have given it to X, Y, or Z. He didn't say that. He's just crapping on Freddie because Freddie hasn't been a coach in the past. I don't think that's a problem. I really don't.
You're not happy? Look at him. Does he look happy?
We've talked about this already.
Saquon Barkley came out. This got buried in the story. Saquon Barkley came out, and this as well-sourced as ago I said in Aaron Rodgers. Read his bot. By the way, NFL executives, said what? With 40 minutes in college, and he's been, this is the story about the Browns. They're with him. Again, Kareem Hunt, by the way, got suspended in college, and he's been suspended in the NFL, so he's got a little bit of stuff with him. Again, basic general sourcing, you can figure that out.
Yeah.
But this is the story about the Browns that everybody's afraid to just talk about. Odell didn't want to go here.
It's wrong.
Odell's not happy. The owner's a control freak. John Dorsey's a control freak. Freddie Kitchens could be over his head.
It's wrong.
I'm not even mentioning Baker, who's a kid. He's just a baby. You're going to get blowback if you say this stuff because everybody wants to celebrate Odell. Odell Beckham didn't want to go to Cleveland.
Wow. That's it, guys. I guess we should just pack it in. Let's not even bother playing. Let's not even show up. You know, we could be a dumpster fire. Let's just go 1-15 because Colin says that we don't deserve to even play on the field. You know, it could be bad. Yeah. Instead, really, what Colin's doing is he's using this for clickbait. He's making these clicks. He's making these takes because he knows that he's going to get a reaction from Baker. He knows that Baker's very popular. He's going to get a reaction from the Browns fan who have proven on Twitter, like he says, and on the rest of the internet that we are a very passionate fan base. And right, so this is what he's doing. He's getting us all riled up, and he's kicked the hornet's nest. You kicked it, and so you're in for a world of hate, Colin. And I don't think anybody's going to be buying a beer for you in Cleveland anytime soon. All right, guys, thanks for watching. Please click the subscribe button. Just click it. Just click it right now. Click the subscribe button. Get it out of the way. I've got some other great videos that are coming right around the corner. So click that subscribe button, get yourself in, click the notification button too, do all that great kind of stuff, right? So it's going to come up. Make sure that you're alerted when we got all the new videos that come live. Interact with me on Twitter, do all that kind of stuff too. I appreciate it. And guys, thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.